Okay, friends, welcome to the final phase of the second module. Let us see how the incoming frame is being handled. Okay, now again we are delving a little deeper. Okay, when the frame is sent from, remember our model, we have a sender, there are two routers. Okay, so whenever a sender sends a frame, the router one reads the frame and find out if there is any error. If there is an error, what should it do? If there is an error, it discard it, but if it is not, what does it do? It check for any instruction by the other end data link layer. For example, there is an instruction that look at the final content and find out if the data, the sender is authenticated or not. There is one way of doing it, or whatever. There are many ways of sending some commands at the other end. So, if there is no error, the receiving data layer has to process it, okay, so and take an appropriate action if need be. For authentication, it might need to calculate something, okay, and so we will do it. Okay. And the other critical part is data link and network layer needs to interact with each other for this right delivery. Why it is so? Let us try to see that again. So, there is a packet coming from above and the data link layer constructs that frame. This packet is to be delivered to inside or buried inside this frame, and this frame is sent to the first router, and the packet is delivered to the first router. Okay. Router 1 constructs a new frame. Why it constructs a new frame? There is a reason, we will be looking at that later. It inserts that packet inside the second frame, is carried across. Again, it delivered to this packet. Remember, why this router takes the packet? Remember, it has to process it to figure out who the next receiver is. So, it delivers that packet through the third frame. Okay. So, that is the thing. During interaction, data link and network layer, data link and physical, this is pairs are communicating directly with each other. Okay. So, you please understand both when packet is buried inside frame and frame sender 1, sender is sending to router 1, router 1 is sending to router 2 and so on, pairs are communicating. Okay. The data link and physical layers are communicating and they have to decide a few things. In fact, two very critical things, which type of signals are to be sent. Okay, and that is called coding system, and that is not an easy job. As I said, entire data communication system is designed to deal with this problem. Which type of signals are to be sent, that is the first thing, and second, when the communication starts and when it ends. And there are two different types of communication, one is called synchronous and the other is asynchronous. Synchronous, they are synchronized on time. Asynchronous, there is something called starting part, which indicates the receiver that there is frame is coming up, and so on and so forth. So, these things are critical. Okay. And what the network layer needs to do, now we are going little deeper, please understand. Network layer needs to communicate for, first thing, forwarding routing table related information. Remember, the routing table related information is about telling us who is where. Now, I need to know. So, how do I know who is where? One method is to exchange that information with all your neighbors and get that information from neighbors, and that is being shown. And if you know bit of networking, it is called distance vector protocol, that is being modeled here. You can see that a particular router sends its routing information to all of its neighbors. In the second phase, first neighbor has sent his routing table, second neighbor has sent his routing table, and the third neighbor has sent. So, it has received routing table from all three of its neighbors. Once that is done, it can construct its own routing table. How that exactly is done, we will see later. But this is precisely the job of network layer, and this is, once it generates this routing table, it can do the second part, forwarding. Okay. Looking at this routing table, it can decide where this incoming packet is to be headed to, is to be sent over. Okay. So, peer transport layer peers, they need to interact for many reasons. In fact, we have already seen that for reliability, it has to talk to each other to see whether the segment is received, if not received, but it has to get back the acknowledgement and so on. We have already seen that. Okay. But transport layer is very critical because it talks to other end directly. Okay. There is first thing called retransmission, we have already seen. This is the job of transport layer. The other thing is has to manage the quality of transmission. Sometimes it can do many things. When we study about SCTP, we know what do we mean by quality of transmission. It also manage errors. Okay. So, it can if there is an error, we have already seen that if it is not delivered in time, it retransmits. Okay. So, there is a timeout and all that, those processes are there. It also do something called a flow control. Now, flow control is something where the sender, if the sender starts sending at a faster rate than the receiver can handle, the receiver should be able to specify that please slow down. For example, when you are downloading a web page from your mobile phone and the website resides on a mainframe, it will start sending, blasting at maybe 10 GB/s, but your mobile phone cannot handle it. So, the mobile phone will say please slow down. It is kind of communication that is called flow control. That is also a job of a transport layer. So, is all these things are done by transport layer, and you can see for everything, each one of this, it has to interact. We have already seen it needs interaction for retransmission. For quality of also, you need to find out what exactly the quality mean by the other end. You need to talk to the other end to learn about the quality requirements. For error handling, you will have to report actually. So, you should know. For flow control also, you need to communicate with each other. So, you can see that peers need interaction here as well. For application, you know it is the most common that thing, but let us try to see through a simple simulation. Okay. It says get abc.txt. Now, the FTP client normally sends this request for downloading a file. A mail client sends something called a mail command. Remember application specific commands, mail bstrivedi@glsuniversityac.in. Now, that is a command to be sent to the mail server, or if it is www, is kind of a URL. Okay. And that is to be sent to the web server. Now, each one of the server will be responding back. This FTP server sends back the file, this sends back the mail's response, and this will send back the web page. Okay. So, again you can see that in case of application layer also, you need to communicate. Now, how exactly do these peer communicate? For every peer to communicate, there is a mechanism, and that mechanism is known as a protocol. Okay. And we will be looking at some of the characteristics of the protocol. But please understand, when peers talk to each other, a data link layer of an Ethernet card to Ethernet card, or an IP to IP, or TCP to TCP. So, this peer to peer communication, you need a protocol. Okay. So, let us try to see protocols for communication. First, peers communicate using protocol in an unambiguous way. Unambiguous means the commands are very precise and there is no way the receiver misunderstands what the sender wants. The second, once the introduction gets over, the protocol normally starts with the introduction. Once the introduction gets over, one of them in the protocol, one of them is the initiator, one of them is the responder, but once that is done, both of them can send and receive. Okay. So, then senders knows exactly what to send. Please understand, in protocol you have to know clearly what you need to send, which command you need to send. Receiver also expects the commands to come in a typical sequence and no other way. So, there is no ambiguity actually. Okay. The synchronization is very, very crucial. If the synchronization is not proper, the protocol will fail. For example, the sender is sending customer ID and receiver accepts that thing as customer's account balance, the banking protocol is going to fail. This is an example. Okay. But let us try to see one typical application layer protocol. Why we have taken application layer protocol? Because application layer protocol is very readable. Okay. Every other layer will provide you some similar protocol. Okay. So, let us begin with the SMTP protocol. The server sends, it says that I am glsicd.org and I am ready. And it is also sending 220. 220 is something that machines understand. The latter part, human, the administrators working on these servers and clients understand. The client responds back, hello, I am glsica.org. Okay. And there is something else. Okay. Which whatever is provided additionally are the comments, okay, which carries a lot of meaning for humans but carries no meaning for the protocol itself. Normally server responds back with 250 okay, in a way saying yes, I accept your this thing, okay, and I accept you as a client. This says, remember this mail from command, mail from bhushan@glsica.org. Okay, so client says there is a mail. The server says, okay, fine. This, I know this guy, this person is not blacklisted, so I allow him. It says mail to virul@glsicd.org. Server says fine, I know this, this person is there at my end. Mail to kanu@glsicd.org. Server says no, there is no such user, but please understand it is not completed. The protocol will go on. We have only shown a very small fraction of it. This is an example of a protocol. Both parties send and receive something. Sender sends request, the receiver responds back. Okay. So this is an example of a protocol. So with this, our second module is over. In this second module, remember what we have seen. We have started with, in the first module we have seen the layers, in the second module we have seen the layers as well as the TCP/IP protocol stack, and now we have seen what is the job of each protocol in turn, and one of the most critical part that we have looked at is called protocol, which help peers to communicate. With that note, we will conclude the second module. Before we start the third module, you can understand that these two are very, very critical. So it is better if you go through both these modules very clearly before attempting the third module, because in the third module what we are going to do is to start using complete thing that we have studied in first two modules and see how an actual application utilizes all these layers and protocols to get the job done. With that note, we will conclude. Thank you.